criminals are coming in who are wealthier and more vicious than any of the criminals that you or anybody on the continent have ever seen. As far as I'm concerned, they're the most dangerous people on Earth. People are much more afraid of the Russian mafia than they are of even the Colombians, the American mafia, or the Sicilians and Italian mafia. He is affiliated with the most powerful criminal organization operating in Russia today.
What is your business?
For the past few years, I've been selling wheat and grain.
Educated, multilingual, dealing in corruption, and the corruption that they deal with goes right to the top of the Russian government.
Russia, birthplace of Dostoevsky and Tolstoy, of the Tsars, of Lenin and Stalin, of revolution and huge political ideas, has found itself a new icon. The mobster. Note, if you will, the gold rings round the finger, the gold chain round the neck, the mobile phone permanently glued to the ear, the Versace t-shirt covering the pot belly. This little chap is on sale in the tourist bazaars of Moscow, a city now 10 years into the post-Soviet age, but already beginning to define itself by tolerance of a dangerous new lawlessness that threatens to become its most notorious export. They call Russia the new kleptocracy. Crime, corruption, and violence are rampant. New Russia is still in uneasy transition between the old repression and the new freedoms. But these villains are street hoodlums and pimps, the detritus of any society throughout the world. Although Semion Mogilevich insists on his complete innocence, he has achieved international notoriety as one of the significant Russian crime figures, a shadowy middleman moving effortlessly between the foot soldiers and the powerful brigade commanders of organized crime. We met on his territory, but on our terms, with no questions barred. Mogilevich, camera shy and not a little intimidating, now seeks to set the record straight in his first ever British interview.
I want to ask you a very, very serious question.
No.
The Russian Ministry of Interior files from Department Number 6 refer to you as one of the top crime bosses in Russia, an authority on Russian organized crime. Let me quote from the report. You are said to be a financier who runs prostitution, gambling, and money laundering. Would your own people, the Russians, say this if it is not true?
These are just words. They don't have documents proving that. And the people saying it understand nothing.
He's a sophisticated racketeer who uses a cover of an international businessman to basically convince people, you've got nothing to hide by dealing with me, this is all a mistake, and just take a look at my bank accounts and the people that I run with, and you'll see that this is all an error on the part of the authorities.
Half a world away in Florida is former FBI Special Agent Bob Levinson, recently with the Bureau's anti-organized crime force. Levinson now works the corporate crime beat, but remains the determined nemesis of Mogilevich, the man he's hunted for 10 years.
He's dangerous because he'll get anybody who gets in his way. That is the philosophy that you've got to understand, is that people will smile, people will paint themselves as legitimate businessmen, anyone who gets in their way becomes a target.
And it's become just a little personal, hasn't it?
I'd like to finish the job.
You'd like to see him weighed off?
I'd like to see him brought in, yes.
In May 1995, the FBI, together with Russian, German, and Italian officers, produced this devastating report on organized crime, naming Mogilevich as leader of an organization with some 250 members.
Mogilevich's main activities are listed as arms dealing, trading nuclear material, prostitution, drug dealing, oil deals, and money laundering.
People will be astonished that four nations, including your own, have got together to produce this damning report, and I wonder quite seriously why you think that has happened.
I'd say they're making a mountain out of a molehill.
Why is it that all these disparate, these different people pick on you? I look at you and I don't see a victim. So why do people pick on you?
It's because I smoke so much.
Cigarette Davidov.
Davidov cigarettes.
The report says your organization operates in Central Europe, including Prague, Vienna, Russia, United States, Ukraine, Israel, and the United Kingdom.
If they were saying something concrete, in England you did this, in America you did this, I could say either yes, that did happen, or no, it didn't. They're saying these things exist. How can you prove they don't? None of it happened. How can you explain that none of it happened? Well, how do you explain it? It's impossible to explain it.
The man they call the most dangerous gangster in Russia was born in the Ukraine, the son of quite well-to-do parents. He graduated with an economics degree, earning himself the sobriquet of the Brainy Don. He was twice jailed in the 70s for minor currency offenses. Mogilevich is a self-confessed lifelong and instinctive capitalist. While in the gulags, his network included hardened criminals, relationships that have endured to this day. The most notorious is with Sergei Mikhailov, reputedly head of Moscow's much-feared Solzhenitskaya gang.
Sergei Anatolievich Mikhailov, also known as Mihas, is the principal leader of the Solzhenitskaya organization. Operates right now out of Moscow. He has 1,000 men under him. He has a number of brigades. They each have a territory that they're responsible for. They conduct extortions, drug trafficking, arms trafficking, prostitution, and they launder the proceeds of much of these activities through Mr. Mogilevich.
Ten years of democratic capitalism have brought little change to the streets of working-class Moscow, where violent death remains a frequent and casual tragedy. Small news. Little of the promised prosperity that was supposed to accompany the economic liberation of New Russia has made its way down from on high to the Muscovites scratching for bargains in the capital's central market. Aching poverty remains etched into a society now existing on an average wage of £2 a day. Any old iron's a bargain here.
I think that was a deep misunderstanding and miscalculation about Russian reform. And the main thing which was miscalculated was that there were no understanding that capitalism without democratic infrastructure, capitalism without laws, capitalism without civil society, without moral and ethic limits, is a wild animal which is eating itself and everybody around it.
Although the new Russian bear seems less intimidating, it's also less inhibited. With the borders now open, Russian crime has slipped its leash and gone transnational. Semyon Mogilevich moved west from Moscow to Prague. Here, the collapse of communism 10 years ago left a vacuum. As the Velvet Revolutionaries threw away the hated implements of dictatorship, they left themselves vulnerable to the new crime infection from the east. The Russians soon made their presence felt.
They were involved in a very wide spectrum of organized crime, ranging from racketeering to arms smuggling, attempts to smuggle radioactive nuclear materials, all activities connected with organized crime.
The biggest rip-off in the new unfettered world of Klondike capitalism involved multi-million dollar rackets in oils and petrols. About a third of all the petrol and diesel pumped into their fuel tanks by Czech motorists went untaxed. The trick was that whereas light fuel oil in the Republic was not taxable, diesel drew a heavy excise duty. So the Russian mafia used various frauds to make massive rip-offs. Sometimes the real rail tanker oil identities were carefully disguised. Or the actual oil inside the tankers was chemically adulterated to change its true characteristics. This huge racket robbed the Czech government of enough revenue to build 50 brand new hospitals.
They're very intelligent. A lot of them have, you know, master's degrees. And they love frauds, because they'll go right after the government, which is the biggest money producer around. So they can generate huge amounts of money real fast.
And with those vast profits came the violence and the car bombings as the Russians and Czechs fought turf wars for domination of the oil rackets. Winners took all, losers paid with their lives. By May 1995, Prague had become crime heaven for Russian gangsters. The Godfathers, feeling safe and confident here, decided to hold a rare Russian crime summit to celebrate successes and plan a profitable future. The venue was the Uhulubu restaurant, part of a valuable downtown Prague center owned by a company which had recently been run by Mogilevich. In the basement, his black and white bar, a famous Czech clip joint which boasted girls unlimited.
In May of 1995, the number two man in the most powerful gang, the Sonsovskaya organization, a man by the name of Viktor Averin, was celebrating a birthday. Traditionally, the birthdays are used as an excuse to get members of the group together, primarily the leaders, the brigade leaders. And so a meeting was planned. We got wind of it.
The FBI saw Averin's birthday guest list as a who's still who of Russian organized crime. There was Sergei Mikhailov, alleged head of the notorious Solzhenitsyna organization, a gang linked by the FBI to Mogilevich. Gafur Rakhamov, the most powerful gangster in Uzbekistan, allegedly a major trafficker of heroin into Europe. Zhumar Khachitsky, narcotics, Moscow. And Alexander Sedov, reputedly one of the most vicious killers in Russia.
They were having an elaborate dinner and entertainment. They had a Russian singer and a comic, and they had some like cabaret entertainers. And everyone was having a very, very good time for themselves. Somewhere in the middle of the performances, ropes from the ceiling came down, and members of the Czech Republic's organized crime SWAT team came into the restaurant, jumped on the stage, and with machine guns basically ordered the crowd not to move. Everyone was transfixed, thinking it was part of the show. It was an elaborate joke at their expense. Slowly, people realized that the men in the black clothing with the machine guns were not a joke, but the real thing.
It was also a rotten night out for the girls from the Black and White Club, as they too were hauled off, still in their working costumes, by an enthusiastic SWAT squad. This was a deliberate humiliation designed to warn Mogilevich that even the minor figures in his empire were not immune.
Everyone was identified. They were photographed. The cameras were seized. And basically to get, in effect, an order of battle from this organization and identify the players, it was a very successful raid.
But the one man who escaped the indignity, the one man the Czechs and FBI most wanted to have a chat with, avoided being in the restaurant that night. By a remarkable twist of fate, Mogilevich flew in for the party, but it appears his plane arrived late.
Were you intending to go to that party?
Yes.
Why didn't you go?
By the time I arrived at Holobu, everything was already in full swing. So I went to a neighboring hotel and sat in the bar there until about 5 or 6 in the morning.
No one was ever charged, no criminal offense had been committed. But the message from the Czech police to the Russian brigade commanders was clear enough. Get out and stay out.
The Uhulubu operation was one of those rare successful police strikes against Russian organized crime. And it forced some of the mobsters to move south, here to Hungary and Budapest.
And they brought their tradecraft with them. This was Zoltán Seres, a Hungarian friend of Mogilevich, whose armor-plated Bentley didn't protect him from the anti-tank ammunition that took his life. Seres was the victim of the Russian-Hungarian turf wars, which have followed the old rackets as pestilence follows infection. In Hungary so far, over 100 gangland murders, 170 explosions, countless kidnappings, tortures, and disappearances. Mogilevich made Budapest his second home in the 90s. His public profile was of involvement in the exotic nighttime world, and he established a local chapter of the ubiquitous black and white clip joint. But quietly, he also worked at various legitimate businesses, and the police left him and his girly club alone.
Were there prostitutes in the club?
I think unlikely. It was a topless bar.
Did the girls go to bed with the clients?
There weren't any beds there. It was a standing bar with tables.
But could money have come in which came from prostitution, perhaps without your being aware?
It is unlikely. The vice police who control the club and who gave it a license have a representative there on a permanent basis.
And policemen never take bribes?
Not the Hungarians. I've heard they do sometimes in England. In America, they always accept bribes.
Another plausible denial. But this nervous Hungarian gangster, seen questioned here by detectives, may have been the first person with evidence to indict Mogilevich on the oil rackets. This is Tamás Boris telling all he knows. There'd been a dispute with the Russians over the oil rackets, and they'd threatened him. Suddenly, detectives heard a familiar name, Saver, the nickname for Semion Mogilevich.
Everything started with a man called Saver. I think he's the one. He's unapproachable, and I think that he's involved in the oil scam right up to this very day. People I know have been up to his office on many occasions, but I've never taken part in any of the meetings. I knew they brought away with them $1 million, $700,000, something like this.
Who's Saver?
He's an older guy from Kiev. I've only seen him once. He's a big, fat man with a big belly. As far as I know, he's the main link outward. He's a businessman who settled here, who has excellent contacts in Russia, particularly the Ukraine. He has very serious connections there.
From this interview on, Boris was already a dead man. A car bomb, the familiar smoke and flames and chaos and death. Tamás Boris and his lawyer assassinated. Two passers-by killed by the blast. It happened in the middle of the tourist section of Budapest. The murderers must have known there'd be innocent victims. Last July, as Boris was passing a white Fiat, his mobile phone rang. When he answered, the Fiat, primed with 9 pounds of TNT, exploded in his face. An early suspect was identified by a prime witness as merely a Ukrainian-born Russian gangster. Circumstantially, that description fitted the billionaire Don.
Each group has a signature. Some groups use a sniper rifle to take out their enemies. Some use a machine gun. Some use a pistol. The group with which Mr. Mogilevich is associated, their signature is the car bomb.
Did you wish him dead?
I was totally indifferent to him. I didn't know him. I haven't even met him.
Were you angry that he was giving police information about you?
I only found out about that after his death. But in addition to myself, there were 20 politicians and 50 other people who also figured in the case. So why was it me who killed him and not one of the other people?
Was it in your interest that he die?
Look, I didn't know the man. It wasn't my line of business. Boris and his friends were selling oil products in Hungary. I was selling wheat.
Did you have anything to do with his murder?
Of course not.
It's true that Mogilevich didn't have a personal hand in the death of Boris, but he didn't need to. There are 200 armed Russian gangsters in Hungary, any one of whom knew only too well how to dispose of a dangerous informant.
Mogilevich's denial of direct personal involvement in the horrific car bomb murder of Boris does stand up to investigation. Here in Budapest, we've discovered there is indeed another Ukrainian-born brigade commander, a much-feared mobster with over 100 men under his control. He happens to run bomb factories. Furthermore, we've been told that he was Mogilevich's right-hand man in Budapest. The truth is, this city remains infected with Russian organized crime problems, a grim warning to the rest of Europe.
Hungary wants to join the European Union in 3 years. Those Russian mobsters who gain citizenship will then be able to cross the EU's boundaries with impunity and take their deadly trades with them. Hungary is the last barrier, but the police remain gloomy.
They settle in Hungary because they like it here. As they get older and have families, it's possible that they won't need to commit crimes, especially if their legal enterprises provide them with sufficient income. The question is whether a younger generation of gangsters will come over to replace them.
That's a very gloomy outlook for the future.
That's the reality.
An even more pressing reality is the inexorable progression of Russian organized crime from the street to the boardroom and big white-collar frauds. Mogilevich, a born capitalist and ruthless entrepreneur, has spent his life taking risks. Russians like him were just waiting for the historical moment to back their hunches, study capitalism's shortcuts, and get very rich very quick, whatever it took. YBM Magnex in Pennsylvania, a lively company that had factories in Hungary and Britain making industrial magnets, typical of the kind of 90s financial opportunity that savvy investors turned to in their thousands. The company's glowing claims and blue ribbon board of directors, many unaware of the truth, propelled YBM's shares from a few cents at their launch on Canadian stock exchanges to over $20 in only 2 years. Everyone started making money, on paper anyway. A year ago, Adrien Duplessis was a talented young financial securities investigator who was asked to take a close look at YBM Magnex. Today, he's back in his original career, his first love, promoting pop music throughout Canada. What he discovered last year about YBM was startling.
What I was able to determine about YBM from the documents was that Semion Mogilevich was an original founder and a controlling interest and, in a sense, the brains or the eminence grise behind the construction of YBM Magnex.
Duplessis knew all about Mogilevich's reputation.
One thing no one has accused Mogilevich of being is a fool. To find him on paper itself is a surprise. And then the fact that we could document him as a shareholder of YBM was a sort of a slip-up. He allowed himself to be caught on paper, which usually doesn't happen in these cases.
Once Duplessis had burrowed deep into the paperwork, the true pattern of YBM's dealings became clear.
YBM was a mix of reality and fantasy, illusion, a sham that at its core had some businesses but was also engaged in a range of things that were entirely fictitious and in other ways very dangerous and illicit.
After Duplessis published his findings, the FBI raided the firm's HQ, the company soon collapsed and went into receivership.
In early 1998, YBM was valued at almost $1 billion Canadian. That paper is all worthless now. The bottom line is the public lost tens of millions, maybe hundreds of millions of dollars in YBM.
Well, I've taken all I'm gonna take from you. Well, I've taken all I'm gonna take from you.
I'd like to talk to you about YBM Magnex.
As much as you like.
You were identified as a company founder and a significant shareholder to YBM Magnex.
I was indeed the founder of the company, but I sold all my shares in 1996.
Once the auditors went in and looked at the books, they found tremendous evidence of money laundering and old-fashioned hanky-panky.
Well, if they found old-fashioned hanky-panky, it's up to them to prove it. Unfortunately, I don't have access to FBI files.
We've obtained confidential reports from accountants which point clearly towards malpractice. Companies affiliated to YBM conducted transactions which raised the specter of money laundering and were highly suspicious. The firm did business with companies that were shells, shells within shells, or simply didn't exist. Some of the company's original shareholders were members of a Russian organized crime syndicate.
A company like YBM, with the white-collar fraud and the millions of dollars lost to investors and pensioners, brings with it the importation of the organized crime elements that are engaged in far more, to the average person, serious crimes, the drug dealing, the prostitution, the extortions, the murders. The more violent nature of organized crime is part and parcel with the white-collar crimes.
But even as the YBM scam was up and running, Mogilevich had turned his business interest to London. His very presence prompted a preemptive strike by British police against the billionaire Don. In early 1995, when he was suspected of being behind a huge money laundering operation, the National Criminal Intelligence Service launched Operation Sword, a close look at his curious UK business. One of the British companies controlled by Mogilevich was Aragon Limited, an offshore, off-the-shelf Channel Islands number with worldwide money laundering connections. Aragon was owned by YBM Magnex, and in turn, it owned Mogilevich's black and white sex club in Prague.
Aragon was probably the principal of a number of front companies used by Mogilevich, we believe, to launder money that was the proceeds of extortion, arms trafficking, probably prostitution as well. Aragon is one of a number of companies that were used to get this money into the mainstream of commerce, to disguise it, to make it legitimate.
Why did you set up companies in the Channel Islands?
The problem was that I didn't know any other island. When they taught us geography at school, I was sick that day.
What made you choose that location?
I didn't choose it. I bought an off-the-shelf company.
And it happened to be an offshore company?
No, I wanted an offshore company.
Why?
To pay less taxes.
Did you try to launder any money through that company?
No, of course not.
Operation Sword established that over £30 million had passed through various accounts in London in a three-year period. £2 million from Aragon, found at the Royal Bank of Scotland, originated from dubious sources in Russia. Warrants of arrest for conspiracy to handle stolen goods were obtained against Mogilevich, but then everything went wrong.
Operation Sword was finally blunted here in Moscow when the Russian police failed to deliver evidence to Scotland Yard that the money had emanated from criminal activities, that it was dirty money. So the investigation collapsed, allegations were withdrawn, compensation was paid. But shortly afterwards, Mr. Mogilevich received a polite letter from the Home Office telling him his presence was no longer welcome in the United Kingdom
and he remains persona non grata to this day.
But in Russia, he still gets the VIP treatment and is rarely without a bodyguard who chauffeurs him in his 200,000-pound armor-plated bomb-proof limousine.
I think he personifies the unusual situation in Russia, where you have this symbiotic relationship among business, government, and crime. And as a result of that, it's difficult to know who the players are, who's wearing what hat at what time. But it also means that somebody who's primarily involved in criminal activities doesn't necessarily perceive them that way. They perceive this as business. And business is sort of on a spectrum of some of it's a little more illegal than others, but it's basically all business. It's just sort of a kind of a rampant or a Wild West kind of capitalism that has not yet been reined in and brought under certain controls, legal controls or others.
Nothing better illustrates this paradox of controlled anarchy than the corruption and farce currently surrounding a scandal that goes to the very top of Russian political life. It touches President Boris Yeltsin and his two daughters. It all began with this man, Yuri Skuratov, the powerful Russian federal prosecutor and the man nominally responsible for stamping out Russian organized crime. Skuratov, never far from the headlines, conducted this task as well as he could, but by 1997 he was being overwhelmed. There'd been a series of contract killings of bankers and investigative reporters. Some 13 had been murdered in Russia. The funerals focused world anxiety on what was happening to Russia's fragile freedoms. In response, President Yeltsin summoned Skuratov to the Kremlin. Skuratov was honored, until he realized he was the scapegoat.
Yuri Ilyich, I would like to express my dissatisfaction about the state of your department. Firstly, the leadership of the department is not being conducted in a proper way. The middle and upper ranks of prosecutors are ignoring you and simply not obeying your orders.
Stung by this humiliation, a re-energized Skuratov began investigating a huge scandal involving alleged backhanders for multi-million dollar cleaning and renovation contracts for the Kremlin and other top government properties in Moscow. The lush contracts have been awarded to this man, the boss of a Swiss company called Mabitex. He's denied paying bribes to top people near the Russian presidency in order to get the work. One claim involves an alleged payment of $1 million into a bank account in Budapest, believed to be controlled by Yeltsin. Furthermore, Swiss investigators have uncovered credit cards in the names of Yeltsin's two daughters. Russian law forbids citizens from holding foreign accounts. The Kremlin denies all allegations. But investigators in Geneva have now discovered that the cards exist and have actually been used in Switzerland. Furthermore, over 40 Swiss bank accounts are now being examined by magistrates in connection with possible money laundering offences. President Yeltsin himself is above prosecution. His two politically powerful daughters are not. It was the then Swiss federal prosecutor Carlo Del Ponte who brought the original tip on the potentially explosive scandal to Moscow earlier this year.
The Swiss prosecution twice informed me of the matter. They provided me with both verbal information and documentary evidence. The prosecutor in charge of the Mabitex affair carried out a painstaking examination. I confirmed that the allegations in Switzerland were true.
At this sensitive stage, Skuratov suddenly appeared on television again. A Moscow station showed him flat out on the job, but more informally dressed than usual. Skuratov was brutally compromised on hidden video, a low blow even by Russian standards. He remains deeply embittered.
Do you believe you were set up?
There is no doubt that I was the victim of an orchestrated plot.
What has happened to your investigation since your removal?
I have to say that initially, just after I left, the investigation was progressing more or less smoothly. But then, when the Kremlin administration realized the implications of the investigation, it began its attempt to sabotage it, to change the investigator, and ultimately to close the case.
Is it a coincidence that Skuratov was trapped and the film shown publicly at the very time that he's investigating the Mabutex affair?
No, it's not, definitely not a coincidence. I mean, this was the danger. This guy was like a loose cannon. I mean, he was liable to do something that was going to seriously damage the family and seriously damage its standing in the Kremlin and in the government and so on. And this cannot be tolerated.
Since these events, Skuratov has been fired by Yeltsin more times than a circus cannon. But Parliament won't endorse the dismissal, so Skuratov remains in place, in limbo and in disgrace. Meanwhile, the Mabutex investigation remains stalled. All very neat. As communism bows out, the West's determination to maintain Yeltsin and his fragile democracy has begun to extract a high price. Russia is still experimenting with capitalism, but for many, the journey to the promised land is taking too long, and there are just too many mountains to climb. The looting of Russia's vast wealth could yet provoke a popular backlash against a criminal elite. Russia's been there before. Semion Mogilevich may have begun to set the fashion for the new Russian bad guy, but that confident swagger could be a front. He knows he's banned from Britain and the United States, while in Budapest, government accountants are crawling all over his financial records. Meanwhile, his sworn enemy remains relentless.
I've not given up. I continue to talk to as many of my sources, old sources, new sources, and get that information in the hands of the proper authorities so that the special agents and the investigators can basically build a case.
But even the downfall of the billionaire Don would be a small victory in a war rolling relentlessly west. Russian crime, organized, ruthless, violent and greedy, is on the move. The Russians are coming, and this time there's no wall to hold them back.
Russian organized crime leaders, their members, their associates are moving into Western Europe. They are purchasing property. They are establishing bank accounts. They're establishing companies. They are weaving themselves into the fabric of society. And by the time that Europe develops an awareness, it's going to be too late.
You can comment on the issues raised in tonight's program by visiting our website at bbc.co.uk/panorama. And next week, the Blair Mayor Project, how Labour is trying to fix who'll be London's mayor.